took her home.
Ah, everybody. So, hey, how are you? This has been a fun one for me. I researched it a lot, and the first thing I did is I went to Shut Up and Play. Andy, if you guys know Andy, he teaches great song lessons on his YouTube channel. Go check him out if you want. And the way he solved this problem of what it really is he went... So this... is what he said is how it really is. Now, of course, we all know that there's a guitar on each side and they're doing different things. But I'll tell you this. I looked at a great YouTube video, and you can check it out, of this band, Free, and Paul Kossoff, at the Isle of Wight in 1970. And I can definitely hear him, you know, they're at a huge stage in the middle of the afternoon, and it's just one guitar, and he's going... So the way he solved his own problem of the two guitar parts was to do exactly what Andy says on Shut Up and Play. So that's what I think. I think it's right. Now, I have a confession to make. I spent my whole life playing this wrong because I just didn't look at it close enough. I spent my whole life playing it, which sounds decent, but it really goes to show that you really should investigate stuff and look at it deeply to make sure you're actually capturing what the musician is doing, because there's something very unique about this. And some people have better ears and they can go right to the right thing, but you know, if you're just, you know, riding your horse and looking at it from a distance and you go, yeah, I got it, and you play it your whole life that way, it's kind of a shock to go, oh, I never really played that right and now I can, which is cool. So if it's one guitar, which we usually are one guitar when we're playing this, that's how Paul solved it on stage. So this has all five strings, and then this has four strings. Now, we're going to get to the solo in a second, but I want to talk about the chorus, because what blows me away about the chorus is these bands, they were so elegant in their simplicity. So this chorus part is... Now, what blows me away is having the strength to actually go, this simple two-note part is our huge rock chorus. It just blows me away. And it's not even that distorted, and it's not that big, because of the way the band, the ensemble functions with the drums, the bass, the guitars, and then Paul Rogers, one of the greatest singers of all time, it's the right part. And that's really, I don't know if people really do that today. It's just, it's so simple and so unadorned, and, you know, we could even say naked. And that's the huge rock chorus. The other thing I learned is that they had a really bad gig, this band, and they ran off stage one night, and they were so disgusted with how the audience didn't respond to their songs that they wrote this to try and make a song that the audience would respond to. And boy, did they. The other thing I want to say about Paul Rodgers is I saw him about 4 years ago, maybe 3.5 years ago, and he sings better today than he did back then. I kid you not. If you get a chance to go see Paul Rodgers live, you'll be blown away because, you know, he's got all these songs from Free, and then he's got all the songs from his Bad Company days. So many great songs, and his voice is basically running at 100%. It's pretty amazing. So what I'd like to do now is just look at the solo. Let me get my position here. Okay, it's a cool solo. It's not that long, but the way he does everything slightly differently each time, and that's kind of the genius of it. The other thing is, and people talk about this, his vibrato. My vibrato is more a slow. Maybe my vibrato comes from Hendrix and Johnny Winter. That's where I got mine from. It's kind of slow, and it's default slow. I just do that every time. Here, let me step on the microamp. But Paul Kossoff's vibrato is frantic, but it's frantic, but it's musical too. I mean, I almost can't do it some of the time because it's so fast. It's easier with my second finger and my index finger. So let's dive in and listen to some of these licks and talk about them and how unique they are and how, once again, simple and elegant they are. See what he does? He pulls up. And then, and he's choosing when to vibrato and not. And I heard Tom Bukovac talk about this in one of his videos about how, you know, you should choose when to vibrato and not. And this solo is a perfect example of that. And I'll show you. He pulls up. And then he pauses, and then he vibratos. And it's a really frantic vibrato, but it's musical. It's like a rubber band, right? So cool. Then up here. Okay, that phrase has no vibrato. Okay, and then the next time he plays it, it's crazy vibrato. Let's listen. Here we go. I love how he does it a little late each time. He hesitates. Let me try it up here. I gotta work on that. Much easier with my index finger than with my second or third finger, I think. But it's so cool. Okay, I want to talk about that one note before we move on. There's a picture on the internet of him in the studio, Paul in the studio. And he's sitting literally right next to a Marshall and a 412 cabinet. There's a super reverb there too. But the cabinet that's mic'd up is the Marshall. And if you sit next to a 412 cabinet, there's so much sound that goes through your chest, your body, and the guitar that you can play one note. And the guitar will vibrate so much that it sustains forever. And that's what you're hearing right here. It's pretty great. It never stops until he starts the next phrase. It's infinite. So he does that fill, and then the first time he pulls up, and it's real lazy and languid, and then the next time he blends in the high E. And then the next time it's even more slow. I mean, these subtle things are what make it great. You know, a lot of guitar players, they don't massage stuff like this. It's like, it's English on the guitar. It's crazy. So now let me move to the last two phrases. So, and it's that crazy vibrato. If you watch him, film of him, he's kind of got that Jared James Nichols kind of wild mad thing where his teeth are showing. It's kind of crazy. He kind of looks like he sounds. Yeah, so I learned a lot from learning this solo. It's just amazing. You can go back and learn so much from these guys. One thing I wanted to mention, there's a sale on the Masterclass this weekend only. It's a pretty good discount, so take a look at it and see if you're interested. We're up to about 1,700 videos and 140 hours of content. And there is a brand new beginner section, which is up to about 90 videos, and I'm going to keep adding to that. I'm building that as we go, but there's plenty there already for beginners. So good sale this weekend if you want to take advantage of it. So I think what I'll do is I'm going to play a little bit over, just do my own thing a little bit for a second because it's always super fun, and then we'll take some questions. So thanks for joining today. This really is a fun one. Oh, and before I do that, let me just talk about what I'm using. This is a reissue Les Paul that I bought probably about 20 years ago. I've had it forever. I'd like to put new frets on it, actually, because the frets are not that tall, but that's another story. I'm plugged into this old Marshall PA head that I got for doing 5 days of work on Paul Reed Smith's school last year. He kind of did a trade with me for it. It's a 1967 PA head, and it really, in one of the photos, in fact, the photo on this actual video on YouTube, you can see there's a PA head back behind Paul Kossoff. So kind of has the same circuit. Channel 2 on this sounds really good, so I'm using channel 2. And then it goes into a Marshall 412 cabinet and then through microphones into Pro Tools. So it's great to use that. And then I'm using my microamp, which is the black version of this, the custom audio electronics version of this, really inexpensive pedal that I use for boost. Still, in some ways, my favorite way to boost a tone and get a lead tone going. One last thing before I start jamming. The trick with this is you're playing rhythm and lead kind of at the same time, you know. So on the rhythm sound, it's kind of just distorted enough to have size, but clean enough to be able to hear the notes. And it can't be too bright, because if it's too bright, when I step on the microamp and I play these notes, it sounds thin. So I spent a couple of days just tweaking sounds to get this tone, because it has to be clear enough on the rhythm sound that you hear everything, and that requires some brightness. But when you use the single note stuff on the lead tone, it can't be too bright. It's very easy to turn the treble knob too far and it thins out. So that's something to pay attention to tone-wise, is you're always playing both ends against the middle if you're trying to get two different tones on a song. Dan O is asking if I care about what pickups are in the guitar. I do, but I'll tell you this. Pickup technology has gotten so good that almost any company you buy from at this point is making an astoundingly good version of a PAF or whatever. It's just gotten so good. Wasn't that way 20 years ago? Wasn't that way 10 years ago? So if you're buying a Lawler or Seymour Duncan or a DiMarzio or anything, it's just gotten so good. So yeah, I think I did replace these pickups at one point, but honestly, I can't remember what they are. I think as the years go by, it would be smart for me to put a piece of tape on the back when I actually put pickups in, so that I can remember, you know, 8 years later or whatever, what I actually put in the thing. But how does my Les Paul stack up against the PRS? That's a really great question. Les Pauls are not as refined. There's a particular mid-range on a Les Paul that no other guitar on the planet has, and that's a cool thing. But a PRS, generally a PRS is going to be, it's going to be built like the best Les Paul. Like you take 1,000 Les Pauls, there's going to be five amazing ones. Well, every PRS out of 1,000 is that quality. So that's really, you know, it's and PRS is staying tuned better because the strings are not turned at the nut as much. So they solve the tuning problem. This guitar is actually staying in tune, but I often have trouble with Gibsons keeping them in tune. It's easy to find an amazing PRS. They're all amazing. It's not that easy to find an amazing Les Paul because they're not all amazing. And it's, you know, it's really, really easy to criticize Gibson. I'm not criticizing Gibson. But that being said, in some ways, it's the greatest sounding guitar ever made because of this particular mid-range that comes from, you know, just the, all the mahogany and the way it's designed. You're right. Les Paul mid-range is called bark. That's perfect. It really has it. It really does. And I don't think any other guitar made has this particular bark. Oh, here's something really good. David Bundy, you were fortunate enough to hang out with Koss. He's had tone knobs on his LP back down to about 3. Oh, that makes so much sense. And his Marshall amp bass control backed way off for a really bright tone. Oh gosh, that's so cool. Right now, I'm gonna turn the tone knob down to 3. Sounds awesome. Asking what the tone setting is, I just turned the tone down to 3 on this tone knob. Now remember, your tone knob on a Les Paul, they're all different depending on what the electronics are inside. So I'm getting a good tone at 3, but sometimes if you turn down your tone knob on a Les Paul, it'll get really dark after 8. So don't take it as a hard and fast rule. Use your ears to find out. It kind of mellows out the lead sound. It's a great trick, and Jeff Mackerlane actually taught me about that. You can check out his channel. So if I have the tone knob on 10, it's good. But if I turn it down to 3, it mellows a little bit. There it is. So there's always a point where it has its effect. And on this particular tone knob, between 10 and 5, not much happens. But when I go down to 3, you can hear that mellowing. And it's a good sound. I definitely love the edge of breakup. One more reminder, there's a sale on the Masterclass. If you're interested in trying it out, we're up to about 1,700 videos, and there's a new beginner's course. Russ, you saw him on their first tour 10 feet away? Absolutely. The vibrato, that's what blows me away. It's fast, but it's so musical. It's just brilliant. And he chooses when to do it. And he often delays. He starts the note and then adds it. So yeah, I this has been a great lesson for me to learn about how brilliant, you know, his vibrato is. I'm Joe Bonamassa. Rolls right off the tongue. Joe Bonamassa has talked about this forever, and now I understand what he's talking about. Pablo, you're asking if I played on the new recent new recordings of old songs with T-Bone Burnett. I actually did. That was part of the same sessions. So I don't think exactly will be credited because that's not really imperative for these guys. But yes, you're Correct. I am on the new Dylan recordings of old songs with T-Bone Burnett. Absolutely. They apparently have this LP that basically gets cleaner as the needle runs across it. It's got to be astronomically expensive, but they're going to sell, I think, one of these to a buyer at auction. That's what I heard the plan was. This LP is like made out of iPhone glass material. It's indestructible. And it actually gets cleaner as you run the needle over it. So pretty cool idea. Be great if we could all afford them. I mean, I sure love vinyl, but vinyl does have its, you know, issues. Yeah, Bassamana is Joe's evil twin brother. Absolutely. So you're asking about the timing in All Right Now. Well, that's the brilliance of a great guitar player because, so what he does... Okay, then the next time around, he delays it. So he's always shifting, displacing the riffs in different places to keep it interesting and fresh and fun. And up here, I mean... The next time around, it's totally different. Then... He extends that one. So absolutely, it's repetition and variation, I talk about this, are very important. If you repeat something, the audience loves it. It makes it into a hook. But if you repeat something and vary it, then it's even better because it's a refreshed hook and it kind of surprises you as it gives you the satisfaction of the repetition. Right? Yeah, it's the high part on the neck. He displaces it. He plays them differently each time. That thing is sooner on the first one. Okay, now the next time he does it, he delays it. I counted this. The first time he goes, it's on 1, 2... And the second time he does it, it's on 1, 2, 3, 4. So yeah, I studied it. It's different both times. So yeah, good question. I'm glad I was able to answer it. It's when you learn something like this and memorize it, you realize that these little differences make all the difference, right? Yeah, here's a couple more questions I can take. So yes, this is another good thing to bring up, is that he played the A. Now, when you start studying this, and people who listen to each side, one guitar often didn't play the high two strings, but he did use his pinky to bar that. And like I said, when I see them on stage in 1970 playing live, and he's the only guitar player, he does it like this. So there you go. So guys, thank you so much for joining us. I'm going to sign off now. Just play us out, and we'll see you on the next one. Appreciate it a lot. Thanks for joining in from all over the world. See you next time.